here is singer-songwriter, broadcaster, audio-video artist, entertainment agent, and your host for the Dharmic Evolution. It's the master storyteller himself, James Kevin O'Connor.
And welcome back once again to the Dharmic Evolution. So delighted to have this young lady on for the second time. She was on 2 years ago. She's a singer, songwriter, piano player, very, very gifted artist. I'm really happy to have her back and see the growth, the imagination coming to life. I mean, if you thought she was good the first time, what do you hear this? This is going to be cool. She brings a powerful mix of youthful energy and optimism to her alternative pop sound, grounded by lyrical flourishes that often belay a depth and maturity rarely found in someone so young. An artist in the truest sense of the word, her creativity is a form of self-expression, poring over every note and word with the finesse and attention detailed of a painter, probably like Michelangelo. Since she can remember, she has desired nothing more than to make music that is truly memorable and means something to the listener. So it's not Michelangelo, but it's Mikalyn Hay from Canada. So you better strap up your seatbelts because we're taking a ride today on the Dharmic Evolution. Mikalyn, welcome to Dharmic Evolution for the second time.
Yes, thank you.
Yeah, it's good to have you here. And I was playing your music again, and I gotta tell you, man, you've moved into like a whole new vein of Wonderworld.
Thank you. Yeah, I mean, a lot of the stuff I'm writing and putting out now, or haven't even really put out yet, but it's there, kind of waiting to be put out. It's very different than what a lot of people are used to from me. So it's interesting. I'm interested to see how people like it.
Yeah, it's you know, I kind of had this epiphany of just you've moved from being a singer-songwriter, and you're still that, but you're a true artist now. Between your video mm-hmm. and your new music, you're really yeah. embracing the art form of music totally, you know, and it's just wonderful to watch it, you know, to your transition into this next phase.
Thank you so much.
Yeah, it's great. It's great. It's just and I don't want to make anybody stay in suspense too long, so let's get right into it. This is called Prove It.
People think they know you, but they really don't. Not like I do. And you think they care, but they just want to show. If only they knew. I may be too good for you, but I stay. I stay.
Games and
That was absolutely awesome. And now you got to tell me what it felt like when the mix came back and this was all done. Like, how did this like feel to you?
This whole, like, this is part of a EDM project I'm doing in Brazil, which sounds weird, but it's kind of a long story how that even started. I don't even really know myself. They just kind of reached out to me one day. So Prove It's interesting because it had two full transitions. So the first time that I heard it is about a year ago now. And my friend Chris and I had done the whole thing together. We had produced it, written it, done everything, filmed a little video. And hearing that for the first time was like, it was obviously great because, you know, it's a song that you put a lot of time and effort into, and then you're finally hearing the end result. So we put that one out, thought that would be it. You know, it was one of the singles off the EP, and then it got picked to be one of the songs that the Brazilians wanted to take and remix. So then hearing it the second time was crazy because you hear a song that you thought had gone through its full stage.
Right.
And then it's just completely different and it's in a whole new light and it's this like dance pop song. And it was just really cool for me to sit there and be like, this is my voice. Like, this is actually me.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. Like a different person, right?
Mm-hmm.
It must have triggered a lot of adventure in you as a musician and a songwriter, though, because, you know, to hear that and say, wow, it never occurred to me that mm-hmm. I could be this as well as what I've done in the past, you know?
Yeah, it made me want to like go Reven, Brazil. Like,
yeah.
I want to go see that place now.
Yeah, for sure. Well, I'm sure you're going to get invited at some point. I mean, mm-hmm. people are probably going to be crazy about
yeah,
hearing
the music.
Yeah,
already have been, but we couldn't go because it was the end of April.
Yeah, right. Well, you know, summer's coming up. You know, who knows mm-hmm. what can happen. Yeah. So tell me about your life and your crazy world of work and projects and trying to keep all the balls in the air at one time. How is everything going? Last time I talked to you, you were in midterms. Is that past now, hopefully?
Yeah, midterms has passed, which means it's coming into exam season for me.
Yeah.
That's just coming up the end of June. And it's also coming into, oh my God, all my friends are graduating except for me because I'm in grade 11.
Right.
That season. So that's like coming upon us. But it's just crazy to me how fast. Like this year so far, 2019 has just raced by. I felt like 2018 was kind of slow, but this year has just been like that. Like it's crazy to me. 'Cause the workload for me, I'm in grade 11, has picked up a lot. And then the pressure from music and kind of branding and stuff like that has picked up. So I've been working on a lot of that behind the scenes alongside, you know, still taking lessons because I want to grow as much as I can. And you can't really stop learning with music. Like you never really reach a point, I think, where you're like, okay, I know everything. 'Cause I don't think that point exists in music, you know?
No. So, and thank God it doesn't because,
yeah,
you know,
exactly.
If we arrived,
what would we do once we reached it? 'Cause you know, every single passionate musician, if there was a point where you can't get any better, you're going to reach it and then be like, okay, well,
now what?
Now I'm depressed. Like there goes my purpose.
Now I've become a farmer or whatever,
really.
You know?
Really?
So you have school and you've got your studies and then you also study music as a separate piece of your life and then you have to practice and then you have songwriting rehearsals, you're gigging so there's very very little time for Mikalyn time. So what does Mikalyn do as far as chill time just to get away from everything?
I really like to just hang out with my friends.
Yeah.
Because a lot of them don't do music or like they don't do the types of things that I do specifically in music. So it's kind of like hanging out with them. I can see a different perspective. I can show them my songs and they're not going to come at it at a songwriter's point of view. They're going to come at it as a listener. And it's funny because like I do my lessons and stuff, but that's I find similar to like my friends who do sports. They have their practices and they have to do something every day to better themselves. So I feel like music's kind of my sport and they see it as that. So it doesn't really get in the way of being social because people treat it the same as if I played rep basketball or rep volleyball. It's like I have to practice and I have to put designated time every day towards practicing and I can find ways to work around my scheduled practice time to do social work and that type of thing.
Right. Do you feel like after you finish your day, do you do like a gut check and say, you know, did I cover everything? Did I get everything in? And do you feel any anxiety at night, like when you go to bed, if there's something you didn't quite get to?
Yeah, like sometimes I think for me, it's almost an issue that I don't do that. Like, I'm like, oh, homework, like, what is that? I'll just do it tomorrow before class. Like, yeah, with school and stuff like that, I'm like, okay, well, it's fine. Like, right. I feel like I should just kind of have a moment at the end of the day where I'm like, did I check off this? But once it starts like this time of year, I find May and June, I have my calendar all set out. I have checklists on my phone for things I need to do. And especially for the busier months, which for me, once again, are May and June, I have to have a checklist and kind of be like, okay, if I don't do this, then I'm like you said, I'm going to lay in bed and be like, I failed today. Like,
yeah, right.
I have
yeah.
a moment like, oh my God, did I seriously just not do anything today? Like, I can't, I don't have time for that, you know?
Yeah. We tend to beat up on ourselves about things mm-hmm, like this. And, 100%. You know, it's kind of, I call it the puritanical work ethic. You know, it's like we just like slave ourselves and, mm-hmm. and don't give ourselves time to reflect. And I've been trying to do more of that because I feel it's healthy, because sometimes you don't take the time to appreciate the road you've traveled already and yeah. all the navigation you did on it. Mm-hmm. And I think there's something in that for just to say, not necessarily pat yourself on the back, but just to breathe and say,
yeah,
well, it's not, you know, look at, I didn't have this immense body of work mm-hmm. That I have now 2 years ago or 3 years ago.
Exactly.
So, and then I think the stepping stones are good too, because even if you have a bunch of songs that didn't quite measure up to your yeah. expectations, you have to write those to get to the good ones.
And that's what I'm trying to like really get across to like a lot of people that are around me immediately. Cause like if I go and I spend an hour on a song and then I'm like, I don't like it, a lot of people can't wrap their heads around how I can't like it. Like, I just spent 2 hours on it.
Yeah.
But it's like, well, I just don't like it. Like,
yeah,
I finished it. I was like, this isn't working. Time to start new.
Right. I always equate it to the at-bats or the baseball batting average, because,
yeah.
you know, if you look at, you know, like if you have a 300 batting average, you're like a superstar.
Mm-hmm.
And that means you failed 70% of the time to get
exactly.
on base. So, you know, yeah. we have to say that, okay, to get to like a really good set of songs or even one mm-hmm. song, you're going to write 5, 6, sometimes even 10 ones that are just not going to make it, you know. But mm-hmm. I think the learning process and the exercise, you always come away with some new knowledge that even if it's mm-hmm. embedded in your subconscious, it's there. And it's like,
yeah.
oh, yeah, I remember going down this road before, you
yeah.
know, and what happened here. So,
mm-hmm. 100%.
I think we should play another one. This one is called One Day.
Feel no love.
fabulous. I just love the way that opens. The groove just has me rocking, man. That is so
Thank
cool.
You. It's another one of the Brazilian ones.
Yeah, this was really, really good. So one day, conceptually, what's that one about? Like, what does one day reflect lyrically?
Yeah, it's funny because I wrote that one by myself. It started off as like a sad piano song. And that's what I just thought I was going to leave it as. I didn't think I was going to do anything with it. I just thought it was going to stay that way. And then I brought it to a producer who took his take on it. You know, it was great. Like, he had a lot of really good ideas. It just wasn't where I really saw the song going. So after that, I was just kind of like, okay, well, whatever. It's fine. Like, I just won't do anything with the song. Like, tempted it and just it didn't go how I kind of visioned it. So
yeah,
I just was going to put it on the back burner. And it was just like another, I don't know, what I considered just like a breakup song. And then when the Brazil people reached out, I just sent them to it just to see what they thought, because it had produced vocals and stems for that. And then they actually really liked it. And they took this like sad piano song and made it into like a dance rave song. So it went through a whole 360.
Wow, that's cool. So when you're recording, where do you record? Like, do you have a place near you that you go?
Yeah, so I live in Guelph, mm-hmm. which is kind of near Toronto. Not many people know where it is. I mean, it's a nice place to visit if you're near. I wouldn't say fly from like somewhere to go to Guelph specifically.
Right.
But Toronto has a lot of really great studios, and so I tend to go there a lot to record.
Great. What's your process with your production? Do you bring in demos ahead of time? Mm-hmm. Do you guys use charts? Do you guys use the Nashville charting system? How do you guys communicate your ideas to one another?
Yeah, I mean, I wouldn't say I have a method really.
Yeah.
Mine's kind of more whatever the song takes. So like, for example, I know how to write Nashville style charts, and I know how to read them because my piano teacher enforced in me from a very, very long time ago, like when he said it's important you need to learn this, which I couldn't agree more, and I'm so glad he taught me because it's come in handy a lot of times. But the way that I usually do it is just it's me and the producer, or me and the producer and another writer, or sometimes the writer and the producer are the same person, and we brainstorm ideas. We come up with like not a rough demo, but almost like a rough track, like similar to the full version, and then usually the producer will like work on the track, and I'll come back and re-record the vocals once we have like a solid bass and a solid foundation.
It's a good way to work. Because sometimes you know, I work in Nashville a lot, and I'll write something on acoustic, and I'll have like ideas for the entire band, but instead of what I used to do is frame everything out. I'd play the bass part, I'd play, you know, and then I stopped doing that. I said, I really want to get into the imagination of these players because they're so good, you know? So I was just giving them, no, just guitar and voice and that's it. And I'd put in all the accents and things like that. But what would come out would be like, well, now I got to go back and learn this song because it's framed in such a different way that I'm not going to sing it the same way I did, because everything's new, you know. And it's such a great place to be because, you know, it's, again, it's the process of discovery, like what is this song really about and what is it saying to me, you know? So I kind of like that. I kind of like when there's a challenge and everything is not pre-scripted and you're not really 1,000% sure.
Exactly, it's loose and it's like free.
Yeah, because you get better work that way, you know? So when you and Chris are working, what do you generally do? Like when you're writing together, is he a guitar player, or and does he sit in with you and you guys just kind of throw things back and forth at each other?
Well, the good thing about writing with Chris specifically is he's also like my best friend.
Right.
So,
okay.
You know, I go into the writes, not like, for example, we hung out last Thursday. I got up at 5 a.m. to go to Toronto because that's the time the train goes. And I went down for the day and we weren't even planning on writing a song. It just kind of happened. And the way that it works is Chris makes beats and does that type of thing. So he had his computer, he has a setup, and then we just start out with basic piano chords and then build the track around that and then start spitballing like words and lyrics and stuff. And for example, last Thursday, I got up, as I said, 5:30. So our song, we were just freestyling and I was just like, I don't want to talk because I'm tired. I'm tired. And then we just kind of went with that idea of just like being done and tired and like went with it. So it really comes out of nowhere with us because we'll take something that we talked about before and just make it into a song.
It sounds to me like you have fun when you write, which is so important.
So much fun.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And it's like, and the thrill of completing a new song just for me, because I'm a little bit older than you, and it's still the same. It's like the same as when I wrote my first song all these years ago. It's like, I feel like I just like climbed Mount Everest every time. You know, it's like, you know, that feeling of elation of, wow, now that's accomplishment. You got a song that's finished, you know, really, really cool. What are your friends like as far as really, really supportive about the music? Do they find it really mysterious? Or, you know, how do they weigh in when they're talking to you about your craft, your career, your determination? And, you know, they must know how serious you are about this.
Yeah, they do know how serious I am. I mean, I still find people at my school that are in my grade that, like, I'll post something about a video that I've done and they're like, oh my God, you sing? And I'm like, yeah, I have been for the past like 7 years.
Yeah.
And it's like my close friends and stuff, they'll come to my gigs and they'll support me that way. They'll listen to my music. They'll post about it on their stories. So I'm so lucky that I have such supportive people around me. Cause you know, I could have the people that are like, okay, well it's music. Like there's no money, like have fun with your 0.0005%. per stream,
right?
Those, that type of thing,
right?
But luckily I have people that are very supportive and they ask about it and they're like, how's music going and that type of thing. So
they must
really,
they must love it when you do a live performance, come out and you know, visit and get the vibe of what's actually going on, you know, that emotion that's carried through the room.
You know, it's a lot of fun.
Yeah.
I love doing it live.
And you seem to have, like, I see you playing out a lot. I see you posting a lot of, you know, some of your performances. There seems to be a nice little niche of places to play, thankfully, around you, which is great, you know? And what's your favorite spot to play besides, like, you know, Yankee Stadium in New York City? Like,
I mean, my favorite place in Guelph where I live is this little place called Red Brick Cafe, and it becomes a lounge in the night, and it is just so, it's so cool. It's like a really cute little place and they pay their musicians, which is always nice.
Yeah.
The people listen. And then I'd say my favorite place in Toronto and places like that would probably be, there's this place called B-Side Lounge, which I had a lot of fun playing at. And then also there's this little place in Goderich that I did a show at once, and it's called Kate's Cafe. And first of all, best BLT I've ever had in my entire life.
At Kate's Cafe?
Yeah, Kate's Cafe in Goderich. They make their own croissants in the basement of the cafe, and they're phenomenal. And it's also just like a really cute place, a really good environment. And everybody, like people that I didn't even know, came out specifically to listen.
Right.
And it was just so interactive. It was so much fun. And then I went back the next day and that's when I had the food. And I was like, oh my God, the food here is great too. Like, it's a perfect place.
Yeah.
So,
it's tough to eat when you're performing, you know?
Oh, I can't. Like I can't eat dairy before I perform.
Yeah. I'm like 4 hours or so, because singing is like, you know, you got to know to be a singer what that's like. You can't do it. So let's do another one. This is Deep End. Here we go. This is heavy.
There was something in your eyes went click. Saw you standing in the back room with your tattoos, and I knew I should've turned away. You were about to give my world a shake, and I never really felt this way. These people don't do much for me. You got something a little extra. Normally I don't, but I think I let you get to know me. Maybe hold me if you're lucky. The pressure's getting stronger, the room is getting hotter. hands, they grip my collar, gripping on my collar, and you're stopping me from leaving. The pressure's getting stronger, the room is getting hotter. Your hands, they grip my collar, gripping on my collar, and you're stopping me from leaving. Let's keep it secret. Every step now, in my head now, and you know that I won't shut you down, cause I like how this is turning out. Yeah, you know me, you can hold me if you're lucky. Yeah, the pressure's getting stronger, the room is getting hotter. Your hands, they grip my collar, gripping on my collar, and you're stopping me from leaving. Pressure's getting stronger, the room is getting hotter. Your hands, they grip my collar, gripping on my collar, and you're stopping me from leaving. Let's keep it secret.
This is so awesome because you kind of approached it like you're almost doing a riff like a horn player would do in the intro to that, you know, the melody.
Yeah, and it was fun when we were writing that song. The producer, I wrote it. It was our first song that I ever written with this producer, Ian, and he was just so much like, he was so easy to kind of talk to, and we started it on piano, and then we're just like spitting out with that specific melody, like the like that type of thing. So
very, very cool. Love that. You got a vivid imagination. What's Ian's last name?
Ian Smith.
Where does he work out of
Kitchener? He works at a Kitchener Waterloo.
Oh, cool. Awesome. So what is the next plan with all this wonderful music you're doing now? So what are you going to do next? Are you going to go out and start touring all summer or what?
I wish.
Yeah, right. It's going to be a busy summer. Goes so quick for you though, right?
Oh my God. It's like, I mean, 2 months feels like 2 days, I swear.
Yeah. Yeah. There's not a lot of time to get everything in.
Yeah.
So,
but, for me, I'm in the process of writing and finishing a new EP. And we're putting that out soon. And we're actually starting filming the music video on Sunday. So Chris, my friend that's a producer, also used to be a very well-renowned photographer. And he's very good at video and directing. So he's going to be doing that because he also features on the song. So it's going to be a lot of fun.
Now, do you have a title for the new EP yet?
Yeah, it's called Sleepless Nights.
Sleepless Nights. I like that. And did you write a title track, Sleepless Nights?
Or yeah, that's where we got the title.
Oh,
we
great.
We wrote Sleepless Nights first.
I still love that when the album has a title track to it. I kind of think that's pretty cool. Now, the video you did was really, really good, called Gone, right?
And oh yeah, that was the most insane thing to film I've ever experienced. It was so much fun.
Tell us about the filming of that. And I know it must have gone at least all day long, and maybe even a few days. But with the, you know, you can tell by the quality of the video and the sets and the lighting and everything that it was a real professional, you know, approach and job to the whole thing. Did you have any idea it would be that crazy, that much work and that much fun all at once?
Yeah, like I couldn't have said it better. You know, I had never done a music video with a crew.
Yeah.
And this time I had a full crew, and I'm so used to doing everything myself.
Yeah.
Or with the help of like one or two other people. And people were like asking me what I needed and like being like, no, you don't have to do this. Like, we have like four guys that are specifically supposed to do this. Like, you just go get changed. And I'm like, oh my God.
Well, that was easy.
What? Yeah, it was weird to me. And it was a lot of fun. It was absolutely just like, I didn't sleep that whole trip to LA.
Oh, really?
I did not sleep. I slept like maybe 4 hours and I was there for 3 days. And I was just so awake and like in my element in this place. So it was a lot of fun.
Wow. So have you gone to LA often, or was it just this one time, or you've been there before? Or is...
I had been there before for an audition, and this was my second time. So I'm lucky enough that I got to go twice in 2018.
Yeah.
And that's the only time I've ever been.
And how about New York City? Have you been there?
Yeah, I went once for a choir trip in grade 8, and I really want to go back. I want to go this summer.
Yeah, it's a kind of a magical place, isn't it?
It is.
I'm actually about 40 minutes away, and I've been going there my whole life, and it's like it's still like the same every time. Like the experience is like always new. Like I don't mean
it's
the same.
Gets old.
Yeah, it's just there's so much to do and so many. Mm-hmm. You know, it's such a melting pot of eclectic personalities from all over the world. It's so cool. So let's play this video now. Gone. Here we go. And then I want to talk a little bit about it. Wow, such a cool video. The colors, everything about it. Now, let's talk about the creative approach to this, Mikalyn. Like, how did conceptually you guys, you know, collectively come up with the idea for the colors and just the story as it was told visually.
Mm-hmm. The two main directors on the video, their names were Curt Jefkey and Chancellor Warhol. And they're both two people that I didn't know before, but now I look up to them so much. It's their vision and their artistic direction is insane. They're so in tune with like everybody that they work with. And I called Curt before we filmed and before I went to LA. And I was like, oh, like what kind of colors are we thinking? What kind of outfits? And so we brainstormed the outfits together. And then he told me kind of his idea about like having a tunnel thing and like sitting at an empty piano in the middle of a room. And then we kind of just visualized the colors of the song, which is like blue, purples, and pinks. And it was just a great process for me to experience. I was like, this is unreal. Like, this is how it actually goes in the industry. So
yeah, it was really so beautifully done, the whole thing.
Thank you.
This part of the interview had a little interruption with younger sister Mila coming home from school and using her phone, thereby compromising the resources of the internet. Mikalyn was quick to get her to turn off her phone, giving us a safe pathway to finish the interview. Social media, you're doing well on?
Yeah, social media is something that my generation has definitely grown up with.
Yeah.
So it's never been something that I've had to learn. It's just always been there.
Yeah.
So it's like I have never seen really a world without it.
Right.
So for me, it's just all been the same.
Yeah. You know? Such a different experience for people who haven't been on it. I've kind of been there from the beginning with it and knew it was going to be huge. So and being a musician, it's a little easier because you're just used to you know, tinkering with electronic things or whatever. Yeah. But yeah, it's great because it's so good that you're able to instantly communicate your music. Like, you know, somebody pops up on a Facebook page and, oh, wow, listen, I would have never heard this young lady from Canada, of all places, up in, you know, the Northeast somewhere. And it's just very, very cool. So as we're going to wrap up here, what are you looking forward to this summer, this very, very short summer that's just right around the corner? You've got to pack everything into only two short months. What's going to be your priorities to get done before the door slams shut on you?
Well, I'm sure you're a musician, so you know musicians don't get a summer. We don't ever really stop. It's an all-year-round thing, so that's good for me because this just means I don't have school, so I can dedicate more time or at least more concentrated time to my music. But then that also means it can expand my timetable for my friends and doing social activities. So a lot of my friends have cottages. My boyfriend has a cottage. I really want to go to a cottage. That's just my only goal, is I need to go and write on a boat.
Nice.
And then I'll be happy.
What about a houseboat?
Yeah, exactly. That'd be even better because then I could just write a lot of songs.
Yeah, you might even be able to get a piano on there, like a real piano. That would be cool.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, well, listen, this has been great catching up with you and watching your progress and your career, like really define itself. And you've got such a solid foundation. We've got great songs and your voice is awesome.
Thank you.
It's always a pleasure to check in and see how you're doing, Mikalyn. So thank you very much for being a part of the Dharmic Evolution once again. And any last minute shout out to your fans out there who are looking to see you, looking to support you, what can you say to them?
Well, first of all, I wanted to thank you for having me back. I, of course, love being here. And I want to give a shout out to Jim Catalano. I know he'll be watching. And you can find any of my music on all of the social medias under Mikalyn Music.
And we will include all of your links to everything in the show notes.
Thank you.
Mikalyn, thank you so much. And may God continue to bless you and your music.
Thank you.
Prove it. One day. Deep end. And the video gone. It only hurts because you're gone. We covered a lot of ground today in Guelph, Canada with Mikalyn. The Red Brick Cafe. The B-Side Lounge. the Brazil EDM Project, Lessons, Don Grierson. Midterms are over, but finals are coming up. Kate's Cafe for the best BLT on the planet. Producer Ian Smith, the new EP, Sleepless Nights. And not to forget, Mila in the house. Hey, you can find everything out about Mikalyn at Mikalyn Music. And if you have not yet gone over to the Dharmic Evolution Facebook community page, you should do that. If you're an artist, you can post your content on there, put on your songs, put on your videos, put on your newest tracks, photographs, story, anything. Or if you just want to support another artist, that is awesome also. And check out our website, dharmicevolution.com. You can see the 220 artists and counting on that site, their videos, their stories, their photographs, their touring schedules, whatever it is. That's it for me today. I'm your host for the Dharmic Evolution, James Kevin O'Connor, singer, songwriter, audio, video artist, master storyteller, and international talent agent. So until the next time when we meet again, I'll either see you on the socials or I'll see you from the stage.